Sebastian G, whatever lenses you use have to be excellent in order to achieve 650 magnification. Actually, it can go a lot more. I just use 650 at this point to speed up the video. I can make it up to 1000% if the image is well executed. So let's go to an example here. Now let's see this image from the D500 with the same lens, 16 to 80 at 38 millimeters at f5, she says here. ISO 100, and this happens to be a particularly sharp image, right? Let's upscale the crap out of this. So, image size, and we're going to say how much we want it, 60? 60 by 40. That's gigantic now, right? 60 by 40 is huge. And I'm gonna choose bicubic smoother. And I hit OK. And guess what? The details that are sharp to begin with are going to be sharp no matter what. Now, you want them even more sharpened than that? Sure. Go here, sharpen, smart sharpen. You can actually choose a little bit of reduced noise for this paint here, for the car paint. Because when you over sharpen, it may start, the color may start to change in tiny, tiny little patches. But look at it now. You see? Let's see at the color. Does it have any noise? Oh, look, I don't see any noise. Right? Now, this is blurry. Of course it's blurry. It was blurry to begin with. This was sharp. And it's still sharp. All right? You can see the little screw and everything. Still sharp. So this is approximately 1000% upscaling. 1000% upscaling. Now she used f5. From such a close distance, f5. You want to get more stuff sharp from such a close distance, you know you're going to use f8, f11, something like that, right? I'm just saying that here. The car was stopped anyway, so the speed was not an issue, but she had the speed dialed in anyway because we're driving. But if you're fast enough, quick enough to change the speed to something lower so that you don't pump up the ISO and you shoot at F11, obviously you're going to get also the doorknob sharp. So in the gigantic copy, all this area is going to look very, very sharp. It all matters on the execution, right? Now, let's go to a different image that does not have perfect sharpness to begin with. Now, we all know that my daughter is an impressionist. She doesn't know it. We do because we have seen the evidence. So, we're going to go to an image that I actually printed into a nice 9x12, but we will see what else we could have done with it. Now, this image is a crop, as you can see. And the crop is 13.4 megapixels. That's it. Because this is a D500. It's the same lens, 16 to 80 at 38 millimeters, this time at 4.5. I'm guessing she was going for the separation at 4.5. But it seems that the focus point landed somewhere behind the bridge instead of one of those areas here. So let's see. Let's try to upscale this thing. These are the only edits that I made. Everything else is just shot. Let's try to see what we can do with it. I'm gonna go through three steps. Write them down if you want. Image size. I'm going to choose for the first step preserve details too. And I'm going to say that I wanna print a big poster for the house. A big poster is 24 by 36. Okay? So 36 by 24 in preserved details. And I'm gonna hit OK. Now, without even having to look at the image, I'm gonna go to sharpen, smart sharpen, and I'm going to go to an area that I really care about. Let's say this little piece of wood here, 200%, I have it here. Now, if you do not apply at all, it's going to look like that. If you apply a lot, it's going to look crunchy. So I'm going to go with, let's say, something in the middle. All right. Now, the reason I reduce noise is because of these here. You see the noise that appears? Keep in mind that when you print it, much of this noise is going to disappear on the print. So you don't need to reduce it completely at the expense of your sharpness. You can leave it like this just fine. So we hit, and then I remember that if you wanna print a poster, you have to leave some borders so that the wooden frame of the poster does not overcover the image and it looks ugly. So we're gonna go to image size again to reduce it this time by 2 inches on each side. And this time I'm gonna choose smooth gradients. 34. Reduction with bicubic smooth gradients. And now I'm going to say canvas size 36 by 24, which is the actual print size. So this is going to be printed. That's my print. It already has the borders, so I don't need to use any crappy borders that they sell for an additional price. So this is it. Now, what is 100%? When we say 100%, Fro does this all the time. Let's zoom in at 100%. That's looking at the image at the resolution of the monitor. My monitor is 138 ppi, which means if I click on 100, every inch becomes from here to here in the image. But that's a 32-inch monitor. So you see how the inches have been exaggerated here by almost double? Because this is the actual size at how it's going to look on the wall. This is the actual size. That's how am I looking at it on a 32-inch monitor. And in my eyes, it looks perfectly okay. This duck here may not be... Is that a goose? What the hell is it? May not look exceptionally sharp, but that was not her intention. Her intention was the bridge. That's why probably he shot at 4.5. You wanted the duck sharp as well, shoot at F11, you know. What's stopping you? But over here we have nice texture. We have everything, you know. Now, let's not forget that this is going to be behind plexiglass. So even if you sharpen the crap out of it, the plexiglass is not going to let anybody see the difference. But if anybody goes very close to it and takes a magnifying glass with a flashlight trying to see the details, that is a person that you have to immediately get out of your life. Well, because you have seen this scene with the business cards, the second part of this clip, you don't want people like that in your life. And finally, there is one other small detail that photographers pay attention to in posters. Are the edges sharp? Well, they're sharp enough in my book, because you can always, for example, read that sign over here. You see it? How the hell does this work? And this is at 100% of the monitor, this sign that says closed. And 100% of the print is going to be like this. So the edges are sharp enough. Now, personally, in images like this one, I prefer the edges not to be as sharp as the center, because this creates a nice attention vignetting around the main subject. But if you want them sharper, stop down. Now let's go to this non-CPU lens menu. Because when I reread your comments, I said to myself, this is what he's talking about. I have talked about this in other videos, and I didn't know that it was so basic what you were asking. I thought it was something more complex. I misread it. This is the back of an AIS lens, and as you can see, there is the AIS indentation and the aperture tab. You can flick this with your finger and you see the aperture closing inside. That's the first test that I actually do, and I had it as the first recommended test, one of the first recommended tests in my video on how to evaluate a used lens. You see this tab over here? Because of the tab. So in these lenses that are non-chipped but have the AIS configuration in the back with the tab and the indentation and all that, the camera basically believes your initial aperture setting and counts down accordingly. You don't need to really set them up in the non-CPU lens data menu. This is the Voigtlander 125, and back then I had not set it up at all and I was taking the same pictures. Just the EXIF data didn't provide any information. It's at 0 millimeters f1, whatever. Of course, you can lie here. You can say 2000 millimeter 2.5 or something. You can lie. So here is the Voigtlander 125 at 2.5. And I'm going to go into menu and I'm going to say that this is a 1000 millimeter lens, 2.8, I don't know. And I'm going to hit OK. And we're going to take the picture now. And let's look at the data. What does it say? 1000 millimeter, 2.8. But what if you have a lens with a dummy mount? Basically, a piece of metal. With only function to keep the lens on the camera, but no indentations, AIS or tabs or anything like that. In this case, you're not going to get any EXIF data. The camera doesn't even know it has a lens on it. Now, if you set up something there, of course, you're going to get these values into your EXIF file, and they're going to be the same in all pictures, regardless of what you do with the aperture, because you can still take pictures. You can play with the aperture. You can focus the lens. There's not going to be any problem shooting with the lens. It's just that the EXIF data will be the ones that you put in that menu. And you can put any data you want. So now we have no lens, zero lens. So we're going to go to the non-CPU lens data. We're going to set our second lens to be, let's say, a 6 millimeter lens or 8 millimeter lens, I don't know. Maybe make it 6 at 1.4. Such a lens exists, I don't know. And we're gonna hit OK and we're gonna take a picture. And we took the picture. Now we're gonna review the picture. And we're gonna go to where it has the information, and there it is. 6 millimeter. 1.4. Thomas Ericsson. When I was 14, I bought a Lubitel 2, used, for a price that in today's money would be about $40, that cheap. I also bought a book called Photography. And I was young and my mind was absorbing every technical detail in that book. So everything that I learned back then about speed, aperture, depth of field, blah, blah, I implement to this day. Basically, you learn photography.
Yes, we learn everything else in the German army from the book of instructions.
First of all, don't be afraid to start from the very basics.
So, number one, sit down.
Don't be afraid to carry your notes or your book in the field. And the first time may be a little bumpy, but you're gonna make it the same way the others do as well. In In about 4 months, I'm planning of making a video for a fine art print, a large one, in which I will include all the steps for amateurs, from the setting up of the camera, the settings in the menus, to selecting a lens, to pretty much everything, all the way up to and including hanging the picture on the wall. Every single step. Meanwhile,
I'm like, really? You rejected my digital files? They're perfect. What could be wrong with them? So I take a raw file. I send it to the technicians at the agency. They do their corrections to it, and they FTP the raw file back to me. And there are 22 corrections to my file. 22. I will remember. 22 steps that they had to do to a 5D file to get it right. Now, I'm thinking, how is this possible? Those backlit, 100 speed, great lens. No one else has ever complained about this. And then I open the raw file and I look, and every single thing that they brought up was there. I had just never looked that closely before, nor had anyone else. Now,
and I will probably have found more than 22, because I know that every time I save an image to recheck it 2 days later, I find new things or things that I overcorrected the first time. If you think you need technical help, or you suspect that your image may have problems that you haven't noticed, or your image is boring, and how you make it a better one, zip up 2 RAW files, send them with WeTransfer to this address. I will not mention your name unless you want to. I will not comment on style, taste, composition. I will not comment on whether it's in or out of focus. You already know that. And I will try to fix color aberrations more. I will comment on field curvature, color balance, light balance, things like that. Thanks a lot. Bye.